Americans are pulling out. The invasion mission accomplished. In the capital, life gets back to normal. 2.5 million bananas a week going to Britain again. But there's still the problem of reconciliation. Because the men now wearing blindfolds were yesterday the men in charge. Tonight we report from the island in the sun and in the news. Until 4 years ago, Grenada was ruled by an elected but corrupt right-wing government. Then a bloodless left-wing coup put a Marxist revolutionary government into power. 3 weeks ago, everything changed again. The island's leaders fell out, the Prime Minister and three other ministers were shot. 2 weeks ago, the Americans invaded. The days of the revolutionary government were over. Today, the Governor General is forming an interim government until there can be elections once more. All this among a population of 110,000 people. For many of them, the speed of change has been confusing. For the rest of the world, questions remain about the legitimacy of the American action. This report by Dennis Tuohy.
In Caribbean waters, just off the coast of Grenada, TVI, like other seaborne journalists, has recently been in conflict with US military power. First came a helicopter inspection of our boat. Then the first radio warning.
It's been on the world news this morning that the reporters and television crew is allowed in by boats.
You're absolutely correct. I will not allow you to enter Grenada. Turn to the north now. You understand me?
Yeah, okay. Standing by on 16. Going up again.
Our captain was clearly told that the United States would not welcome our presence in Grenada.
There are no personnel authorized to enter or leave the island of Grenada at this time. Your safety is in danger. Request you clear the island to 12 nautical miles.
We turned to the north, made for another island nearby, and waited for a change of military mood. The change came when Point Salines Airport, the focus of fierce resistance when the invasion took place, had been made secure. Where Cubans once worked, the United States is now in command. America's general anxiety was about Soviet and Cuban strategy in Grenada. Their immediate concern was for the safety of American students in a medical school near the airport. Their action has changed the face and future of the island. Their last prime minister and 100 others were murdered by his rivals. The American landings made their island home a battleground. Fear cut school attendance by half.
Girls, good morning. We all know for the last 2 weeks that what has been happening to our beautiful island is a real nightmare. Never in the history of Grenada or any Caribbean island have the happenings that took place in Grenada for the last 2 weeks has happened. But as you would realize, the past is past. And what we should be concerned the most about is building up Grenada. I don't think many of you knew the old motto of Grenada, brighter out of darkness. And this was one of the first things I said when I got up the morning after that terrible night. Our motto should be brighter out of darkness, to start to rebuild Grenada to that beautiful island, that peaceful island that we once knew.
Folks, have a nice day, all right?
Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Thanks for the trouble.
The fighting is for the most part over, but the price of peace is roadblock vigilance. The Russians and most of the Cubans construction workers, teachers, military advisors, have been deported, if not killed in the fighting.
All righty. Looks okay to me. Folks have a good day, all right?
Okay.
But the search goes on for Grenadians who held key positions in the defeated People's Revolutionary Army.
There's a car behind. Come up here.
Early one morning, we came across this man outside the hotel that is now the U.S. diplomatic mission to Grenada. We weren't allowed near enough to read his name tag.
Colonel, could you explain to me how this man comes to be here?
Yes. Currently on the island are a number of People's Revolutionary Army members, and we have a list published of who they are. We don't know all of them, but we have roadblocks set up on this road and on most of the other major roads here in St. George's. And as we see these people, or as we capture these people, or as they try to move through the roadblock, and we check their identification, we apprehend them, and then we turn them in to the civil authorities here in St. George's.
And this man is waiting to be turned into
That's
the civil...
That's correct, yes.
Have you any idea what's likely to happen to him then?
I don't have the vaguest idea. He'll be questioned, I'm sure, and they'll check his papers. In some cases, they're releasing some of these people who are members just because they were told to be members, as distinct from somebody who's a hardcore leader of the People's Revolutionary Army.
The Americans called their invasion of Grenada Operation Urgent Fury. After the first week, the fury faded, and in the so-called Spice Island, normal patterns of life have begun to re-emerge. Before and during the invasion, desperate looting created food shortages. Supplies are not yet flowing freely to some outlying areas of the island, but for the most part they're adequate, and local businessmen have told the invading forces that they themselves can now handle distribution. Exports too have begun to flow. Bananas for Britain are a key export. Britons eat 2.5 million Grenadian bananas every week. And last weekend, the Geest Company was loading again in St. George's Harbour. The event was marked by a reception on board, attended by Grenada's Governor General, Sir Paul Scoon.
With my people, prior to the coming of the 18 next speaker, notes somebody wrote about Blessing. Anxious to...
Today?
Very, very anxious.
It was a party to promote business confidence and, of course, bananas.
In 1979, the day of the revolution, we had a vessel here and we loaded bananas during the time that they are taking over. And now, a few days after, when we are liberated, we have a vessel here. And we want to be associated with the islands so that we can provide livelihood for everybody concerned. Thank you, gentlemen. Thanks very much for coming.
We promise you, sir, that we are going to plant more and more bananas, and I hope, with the help of friendly governments, we shall get more fertilizers and other things to help the banana industry so that we provide our good friends in the UK with more and better bananas. Long live Great Britain. God save the Queen.
The survival of the Governor General, the Queen's representative in Grenada, has been vital to United States' hopes of establishing a stable political system. It took American troops a day's hard fighting to rescue Sir Paul from his residence, where he'd been a virtual prisoner since the chaos of October the 19th. That was the day that Prime Minister Maurice Bishop was killed by rivals in the revolutionary government. 2 weeks and one invasion later. At Queen's Park Racecourse, St. George's, members of the People's Revolutionary Army, the PRA, and of the Auxiliary Militia are invited to register their names and to submit to questioning. Their future is uncertain, but there's little doubt that most Grenadians have warmly welcomed the arrival of the Americans.
and how to say praise and thanks to the Almighty God that Mr. Reagan sent his people to save us. The spirit of the living God that fell afresh upon us here in Grenada. Otherwise, we would have been a gone ghost story.
Right? Each and every one of us here was afraid of what would happen. Because as we learned, there were so many ammunition and so many guns and bombs in this Grenada. We all would have been gone.
Well, what happened was very serious for us here. So we were so frightened that we don't know what to do now, what to say. We couldn't go outside for some water. One night we leave to go down the pipe for some water, and two PRA with a gun, and they chase us up back. Go inside! What you doing outside? You don't hear us say to stay inside? It was very dangerous. And when I heard that the American come down, I raised my hand and I said, praise God. So we was very happy and proud of what went down.
What do you think will happen to the people who are coming down here to register, people who have been members of the PRA or the militia?
Well, those that that has been taken up, but I still think that some of them could be still dangerous. Because as I understand that some of them haven't given up the small piece, right? And having to capture them and let them go after a certain time, I still think that they will be dangerous.
Let's fill in the seats to the rear.
Going, aye.
Anthony John.
Some of the PRA who came to Queen's Park to register came out by a side entrance and were taken away for further questioning.
Oliver LaCrin. Albert Bishop. Clarence Roberts. Wait there till your name's called. Leroy Ferguson.
All in all, 1,300 people came into Queen's Park. A senior American officer spoke to us on the key question of weapons and whether the PRA had returned them.
Very few turned in arms. We had less than 100 arms actually turned in at the race course. Most of them either told us where they were or told us that they had thrown them away, left them at their barracks, or left them in their homes. We did recover a few more from some homes subsequently, but by and large, we did not get a great number of weapons.
But what about those weapons then? Do they still hold on to them or what?
Well, of course, we really don't know. We were forced to take them at their word. If they threw them away, we've probably found them. If they left them in the barracks, we certainly have them. If they still have them at home and prefer to keep them, there's little we can do other than a house-to-house search of every individual to ferret out those weapons. I don't believe we have plans to do that, at least not for the present.
While interrogation continues, and while helicopter searches still go on for fighters who have not surrendered, reconciliation is a delicate but vital task for the country's Governor General.
Well, I'm always very optimistic. I know my Grenadian people very well, and I think, provided that within 3 months we can sort out people who may have to face some trial for any wrongs they've committed, I think the process of reconciliation will be very good. The church, the schools, and all the voluntary organizations will be helping in this process of reconciliation. And I'm very optimistic about this. We're not going to cause people to remain in prison without trials for any length of time. We have used the state of emergency process, which is allowed under the Constitution to search people and detain them for some time. And once the government is established, we shall proceed towards getting people out of detention and let people live their normal lives again.
Can you give me any idea of the numbers of people who are being held in detention?
At the moment, I'm advised that there are about 60 people who we call prisoners of war.
When you speak of the possibility of charges being brought, presumably those charges will not simply be that they were senior members of the PRA or the militia. They will have had to have committed particular crimes.
Yes, certainly not. In fact, there are ministers of the militia of the PRA and of the government who are quite free. They're present in the homes and nobody's going to interfere with them.
The declared intent of the United States invasion was to protect the lives of 1,000 American residents who were held to be in danger after the bloody events surrounding the death of Prime Minister Maurice Bishop. But captured and abandoned weaponry bears witness to a wider purpose. To deny the Russians and Cubans, backers of the overthrown regime, a strategic stronghold in the Eastern Caribbean. US troops in Grenada have no doubt about what they feel they've achieved. Few people in the island now will openly criticize the Americans. One of the few is Michael, an 18-year-old student.
The people in Grenada don't understand the role of America internationally. People think that America is nice and America will do everything for Grenada. I know that's not right. I know that it's totally wrong. America wouldn't do everything for Grenada, and America only come to dominate the scene and establish big multinational corporations and establish military base if it is possible.
Most of the people seem to welcome the United States arrival. Is there any opposition at all?
No. Right now there is no opposition. There is no, at least I say that the people themselves are the opposition, but the people are scared, really. They are scared in terms that they can't speak. Once they speak against the American invasion, you know, maybe they'll be arrested or so. But most people really don't agree with the American invasion.
Do you think that opposition is likely to grow as the months go by, as the weeks go by?
No. As the years go by.
At the height of the invasion, there were 6,000 American troops on the island. They were supported by 300 from neighboring Caribbean countries, including Barbados and Jamaica. By last weekend, the remaining American military strength was down by more than half, to 2,500. How long the troops that are left behind will stay depends now on how effectively and how soon Grenada's political future can be worked out. Last weekend, a congressional fact-finding mission arrived from Washington, led by Congressman Thomas Foley.
My personal reaction was great anxiety about the decision and great concern. Anytime American forces are deployed in the territory of another country, one is naturally terribly concerned about that. The reaction, the international reaction, was predictably harsh.
What are your feelings about the situation now that you have come?
There was, I think, in this island, a sense of widespread fear and anxiety, which was not only a matter of concern to American citizens, but Grenadians in many numbers. And we have had a great deal of difficulty finding any Grenadian to condemn or criticize the action of the American and Caribbean forces landing here.
What do you think the role of the United States should now be?
Personally, I hope American forces are withdrawn just as soon as possible. I don't mean a matter of days, because I think that'd be extraordinarily difficult. But the Governor General has suggested that he hopes elections will be held somewhere between 6 months and 1 year's time. And I certainly hope that under any circumstances, when that election period approaches, that the security responsibilities on this island are firmly in Grenadian hands or in the hands of cooperating Commonwealth countries, and that there is no significant United States military presence here.
When that election comes, what hope will be offered to the thousands of Grenadians, many of them the young and the poor, who supported and lived by socialist ideals that they thought could offer them a future? Richard Gray, like other leading businessmen on the island, sees that question as a test of good government.
We have to think about giving them something in return, because unemployed people, i.e. no longer employed in the army with guns and so on, are a danger. And it's not a question of arresting arrest that many of the population. We have to give them something else. We have to make them feel that our system is, in fact, better. And so we want to keep all the good things that the previous government started to establish. And part of that is the orientation of youth and so on. We probably want to seek a slightly left of center government, and hope that we can save ourselves from the old saltfish and rum politicians that we used to have here, and to start to build the country again.
The ruins of a People's Revolutionary Army camp, a few miles south of St. George's, where army and militia were trained with Cuban help. Not just the ruins of a camp, but also of a regime and an ill-fated alliance between Revolutionary Grenada and Revolutionary Cuba. Cubans captured after the invasion have already been shipped home to Havana. According to the Governor General, there is now no place for any of their fellow countrymen in Grenada.
They have to leave, because until and unless they leave, we cannot be too happy about the security of this country.
Do you see any possibility of future relations with them or with the Soviet Union?
Certainly. With the Soviet Union, not during the interim government, nor with Libya. And in fact, we can have a very low-key relationship with many of our countries. With respect to Cuba, we have not really severed relationship. We have declared the ambassador persona non grata, and we're going to have a second look at that as soon as the government has been established.
What do you feel about the British role in the events of the last few weeks? I've spoken to quite a few Grenadians who feel disappointed, who feel let down by the, not just the British unwillingness to take part in the action, but the British unwillingness to support the action, clearly.
Well, I'd rather not comment on this. This is a highly charged political question. In my position, I would not like to comment, but very pleased to say that the British have resumed aid for Grenada after some 4.5 years, and we're very happy about that.
How soon do you expect to see the United States forces and the Caribbean forces leave the island?
Well, this is difficult to say. The past week, I think we have done remarkably well in restoring peace and order in Grenada. But we have to be vigilant. We can't take things for granted. And I want to give the assurance that as soon as we think it is absolutely safe for them to go, they would be asked to leave. That we can't take chances.
Do not bear any sort of resentment or ill feeling against anybody in Grenada. Grenada belongs to Grenadians. That's what we want, and that's where you, the students, the young people of Grenada, come in. Because you are the ones who would be in the forefront. Now that you have to be educated, educate yourselves to take your rightful place in this island. Don't think that all is lost.